Hi, I'm Dr. Ken Miller. I'm the director of the Adult Cancer Survivorship Program at the Dana-Farber Cancer Institute. And I'm very fortunate today to have with me Dr. Sharon Bober.
Nice to be here.
Thank you. I want to talk about men and cancer and sexuality and intimacy. There's a lot of discussion about women after cancer treatment. How are men different in regards to their experience after they've been treated for cancer?
Well, obviously it's different because the parts are different, but yep. To be frank, it's actually not that different in that so many men, like so many women, often deal with profound changes in their sexual function after cancer. Sometimes it's an obvious cancer like prostate cancer, where men have sort of either pelvic radiation or prostatectomy and have a direct effect in terms of erectile function. But lots of times our guys who are dealing with head and neck cancer, who are dealing with bone marrow transplant and a variety of other cancers, you know, also report big changes in their sexual function.
How about men in communication? Is it more difficult?
Well, that's a leading question, Ken. well, certainly I think that, you know, communication is a big part of what needs to happen in this topic. I mean, whether it's bringing up the topic with your doctor, with someone on your treatment team, or bringing up the topic with your partner. I sit with so many guys who really feel embarrassed to bring it up. They feel that it's, you know, a big part of their masculinity, and they feel somewhat embarrassed. It's not easy to talk about ED, although it's a lot easier now that we have, you know, Viagra. But the fact is, lots of times a guy will take the little blue pill, and it doesn't work. Then they feel really doubly damaged. And so that's why it's all the more important to know that there are strategies that are very effective for erectile dysfunction, for example, beyond the oral agents.
For men with erectile dysfunction, what options are there in terms of treatment?
Most of us have seen the commercials for the oral drugs, Cialis, Viagra, yep. Levitra. Typically, we will start with that. But for all kinds of reasons, whether they are neurological, vascular, sometimes they don't work. And then often guys will give up. The fact is, we have a whole line of options after that to try. In particular, for example, we will often use injection therapy with a very small gauge diabetic needle. You know, most guys will think, oh, gee, I don't want to think about an injection. The fact is, most guys who use injections find it very manageable, not painful, and it is remarkably successful. And that's essentially a way to deliver medication directly into the side of the penis that will give guys an erection, certainly hard enough for penetration, that work. And that's something that guys can work with typically their local urologist to get that medication. But that is something that is remarkably effective. So that's an example of one option we have that often guys don't know about and is very effective.
Aside from erectile dysfunction, ED, but what are the other things men complain of?
Men really struggle with changes in desire. Mm-hmm. Both arousal and desire can often be profoundly impacted by cancer treatment. And also self-image. I mean, to mm-hmm. be frank, mm-hmm. you know, we look at other cancers that affect, you know, the body. And men, you know, also struggle with body image too. That's not just a female problem.
Right.
So lots of times guys are worried that, you know, they don't look the same and they don't, you know, affects their sense of self-image and confidence. And often are afraid to talk about it with their partner, and you know, then you all of a sudden have a bit of a relationship issue there. And couples often are sort of shy to bring up the topic between the two of them.
Men may think, and women may think also, you know what, there's nothing to do about it. So start to feel quite discouraged. So, you know, if someone basically said that to you, you know what, geez, why bother to get help because it's not, nothing's going to work? Is that true?
No, it's not true. And
thank
I would
you.
Say that is the number one, that's the number one misperception I think that the patients have, that they've gone through heck and high water in order to get over cancer, but that, you know, changes in their sex life are probably something they, you know, are stuck with, but they should be grateful to be alive and there's nothing they could do about it. And that is just not true.
Mm-hmm.
We have an awful lot of strategies for men and for women that work. And that work on issues about, you know, the mechanics, things like erectile function, and also the experience, things like desire and arousal. So there really are lots of things we can do, and it's important that people know that so they can feel that it's worth bringing it up.
To try to prompt this kind of conversation for men to really bring this up, what are some of the questions ideally the doctor would ask, and if the doctor doesn't ask it, how can a man bring it up?
Right. I mean, I think it's really okay for a guy to say to someone on his treatment team with whom he's comfortable, look, you know, sex life is not the way that it used to be, he can be more specific and to say that, you know, for example, I'm having a tough time getting an erection, or, you know, desire is not what it was, I'm looking for some help. And that, you know, it's okay for a provider to say, you know, I'm not exactly sure what to do right now, but let me look into it for you. Mm-hmm. I mean, I think mm-hmm. that's the point, that, you know, doctors don't have to feel as though they can answer the whole question.
Yep.
They just need to be willing to say, let me make a couple of phone calls mm-hmm. and find mm-hmm. out what resources are in the community.
So for men who are, you know, who are having problems with either erectile dysfunction or other changes in sexuality and intimacy, mm-hmm. body image, what are the resources?
Mm-hmm. Well, I think certainly working with a local urologist mm-hmm. who sort of knows the state of the field is going to be a very important element in that equation. I also think that lots of times it's hard to talk about it in terms of the relationship piece, and finding a counselor, a social worker, mm-hmm. someone who's willing to sit with a couple and just help them talk about the topic can be a huge relief. It doesn't mean that they need couples therapy, but it might just mm-hmm. mean that they need a little bit of counseling short term in order to get this on the table, for a couple to realize that it's not a scary topic, that mm-hmm. both mm-hmm. parties, you know, care and are worried about each other and are wanting to protect each other, and that it's actually not as hard to talk about as you think it is.
Sharon, thank you. It's a great opportunity to talk about sexuality for men after treatment of cancer.
Thanks for having me.
And I'm Dr. Ken Miller, and this is another part of our series on living well beyond cancer.